what do we mean by genius, and does that category really matter? Do we really need to study this kind of way of categorizing one individual or another? So let me begin with Dean. You've spent a lot of your career thinking about these kinds of issues. So you just pose the question, you know, who first defined genius? Where does that idea come from?
Well, I mean, the idea of genius itself dates back to the ancient Romans. It used to be thought that every single person was born with a genius. And, well, at least every single male was born with a genius. Women had a women had a Juno, which you probably haven't heard of. And we're not talking about Junos. We're only talking about geniuses. But it was something that was special. It looked out for your welfare. We'd probably call it a guardian angel. And it was a thing that made you kind of unique. So it really didn't have the special connotations that it has today. But later on, after the Renaissance, when we had these incredible geniuses, people like Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci, people started to come up with this idea of genius as being something really special. And notice it's very important, because in this new idea, not everybody had a genius. Only a few people had a genius. And one of the major figures to do this is Immanuel Kant in his critique of aesthetics, or of judgment. And in there, he talked about geniuses as fulfilling two requirements. The first is they have to do something original, something that stands out, different than the crowd. And the second thing, and this is very important, because you got to remember that a lot of crazy people can produce original ideas. They do it all the time. There's even an art museum consisted of nothing but work by mad people. You have to produce something that's not just original, but also exemplary. It's something that other people would look up to and admire and use as a basis for their own creativity. So that was those two things, originality and being exemplary, were the primary things. But it's interesting, I should add this, because we included scientists amongst the genius. According to Kant, only artists could be geniuses. Scientists didn't have to be geniuses because they had the scientific method. He even says Isaac Newton wasn't a genius because he could teach anybody to do what he was doing. So it's an interesting thing. But let me just add one more thing, and that is, since I'm a psychologist, psychologists like to take over other people's fields and other people's ideas. And in the early part of the 20th century, somebody came up with an IQ test and decided to define genius in terms of your IQ score instead of in terms of your exemplary originality. This was actually done at Stanford. And this IQ score was set arbitrarily at 140. And that's ended up in the dictionary. It means you're in the top 1% of the population. That's all it means. And so if you don't produce something that's original and exemplary, then just get a high IQ score. There's two ways of doing it.
So with that definition, is and was genius typically identified early in age with the young, or is it, I have an example. You know, when I was going to high school, I had a high school classmate who maybe some of you know, Mark, you may know, Noam Elkies. You know Noam
Elkies? I know. Yeah.
So he's the youngest tenured mathematician at Harvard. And when I was in high school, you know, we would hang around sometimes, talk about pie and, you know, to sort of break the monotony of those math conversations, I once, you know, said to him that I loved the Brahms Rhapsody in G. And he said to me, oh, do you mean this? And he proceeded to simultaneously whistle and hum two lines of music of that piece. And I just to learn how to hum and whistle at the same, I mean, here we go. You laugh, you try it. No, then this here is it. Hum and whistle at the same time. And to have two separate voices simultaneously, it was clear immediately this guy was just off scale. Right. Is that the kind of way in which genius has been identified?
Well, that's the kind of genius that people often talk about, the polymaths, the people who have multiple skills. And some people argue that general intelligence, they actually call it G, the G factor, can be applied to a lot of different areas. And so if you have tremendous general intelligence, you can learn how to whistle and hum at the same time and do a lot of other things as well. That's your problem.
That's why I'm not over there, right? If I could, I'd be sitting one of your seats.
Right.